So today, I'm going to talk about one such person, Donna Redwing. And I'm going to talk for a bit. And there are a few people in the audience who knew her. And if they want to speak, they can as well. So I'm giving them fair warning. But then I'm actually going to end by trying to show a YouTube video of her. So hopefully that will work. Otherwise, this is going to be a real short service. And I've discovered, you know, with a cold, I think I am now officially a bass when I'm singing.
Wow.
Pretty low there. So Donna Redwing was a civil rights activist who died on April 16th after an 8-month battle with cancer. She was 67 years old. Donna was once called the most dangerous woman in America by the Christian Coalition. She spent over 3 decades advocating for civil rights. Redwing was a native of Massachusetts, which you occasionally picked up when you heard her talk. And she was survived by her wife and partner of more than 30 years, Sumitra, a son Julian, grandson Jasper, and a twin brother, David. Donna was mixed race. She was Native American and white, and time has escaped from me now what tribe she belonged to, but as we refer to them, those of us who are indigenous from this part of the country, call them just generically, one of them damn East Coast Indians. Because, you know, all the immigration problems really stem from them. So, anyhow, and we tease her about that occasionally. So I'm going to start with a synopsis of her professional life. For the last 2 years, Donna had been the executive director of the Eichner Foundation, which is a Des Moines organization promoting tolerance and non-discrimination. Prior to that, she was the executive director of One Iowa from 2012 to 2016. I remember when I heard that Donna was named the executive director of One Iowa, because I immediately thought, Iowa has finally hit the big time. Previously, she was executive director of Grassroots Leadership, which is a community organizing group that helps empower other organizations to work strategically to achieve justice and equality. She was chief of staff from 2003 to 2012 at the Interfaith Alliance in Washington, D.C. She worked at the Gill Foundation as policy director and also outgiving director. She was a field director for the Human Rights Campaign for 3 years. And she was also a field director at the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation. But she first came to my attention in the early 90s when she was out in Oregon. And she worked for the Lesbian Community Project, where she ended up running a statewide effort to defeat legislation that would have required schools to teach that being gay was, quote, abnormal, wrong, unnatural, and perverse, and that these behaviors are to be discouraged and avoided. Now, if you don't know Oregon, you know, we think of Oregon as being very left, very liberal. Yes, in Portland and Eugene, and the whole rest of the state is pretty conservative. They were essentially a sundown state for a long time. So they're very white and pretty conservative outside of the larger metropolitan areas. But she persevered, and the legislation was thankfully did not go forward. And The Advocate, which is a national LGBT newspaper, named Donna as its Woman of the Year in 1992. Donna was the first recipient of the Walter Cronkite Award for Faith and Freedom. She also co-chaired the Obama for America 2008 LGBT Leadership Council. The Des Moines Human and Civil Rights Commission, just about a month and a half ago, renamed their Lifetime Achievement Award after Donna. According to Sharon Malero, who is a lesbian civil rights attorney powerhouse in the Des Moines area, she said of Donna, she never made much money, but filled the hearts and souls of countless friends and thousands who benefited from her life's work, charisma, and positive attitude. Donna was indeed a very potent force for change, but her legacy is less about political differences and more about seeking common ground. In early 2015, Des Moines Register columnist Rika Bezu wrote about an unlikely friendship that sprung up between Donna and Bob Vanderplatz. Bob Vanderplatz, the executive director of the infamous The Family Leader. Donna contacted Bob one day and said she wanted to have coffee with him. And with that started an unlikely friendship. They would meet every month or so for coffee and pastries. And for a long time, no one knew about those meetings. They just respectfully listened to each other. You know, they knew they weren't going to change each other's minds, but they were trying to truly listen to one another. I'd like to think that they were engaging in a different kind of social activism, performing routine maintenance on the civic structure that makes free speech and the free exchange of ideas possible. Donna once quoted the philosopher Martin Marty, who said, "You cannot have justice without argument. So the issue is to make it civil." And there are three important lessons from Donna. The first is to try to see someone's humanity before you see their identity. The more threatened we feel by others' opposing beliefs, the easier it is to treat them badly. And we can justify that in our own minds. The second is to know that your political opponent is not your enemy. This is the difference between someone with whom you disagree and someone with whom you are actively hostile. And finally, no matter our differences, we can work at finding common ground. So having just said that, though, I do have to tell one funny story about Donna. Deb Mandacino and Dee were present for this. It was a few years ago. We were in Minneapolis at a weekend meeting, and it was LGBT people and their allies, and we were, I don't know, 50 or 60 people shoved in a room for about 30, so it was pretty tight. And we from Sioux City, where I think we were in the back row, and Donna was a row or two ahead of us. And at some point, a younger woman of color got up to excoriate us. And some of it was about indigenous people and how we were, you know, failing to realize the ground we were standing on. As Donna and I sat there, the two natives in the room, that this young person had no idea, you know, as native people, we're invisible to many people, even sometimes other people of color. So we had this person just going on, and as I said, excoriating the group. And Donna just turned around, her head, I thought she was gonna snap right off her body. Turned around and with this look in her face and pointed a finger at me. And then I think I got up and it was my turn at that. So anyhow. But Donna did have quite a sense of humor. She could be very funny, very cuttingly so at times. She could put you in your place with a look. She was no one's fool. But she did a lot of amazing things for the LGBT community.